navigate the jet before you put warheads on foreheads, make the enemy die for his country, turn those assholes into hair, teeth, and eyeballs, and all of that other oorah shit. I can't wait. But before we can do that, let's go ahead and press on with the startup. Just let me know when you're ready for taxi, but stand by in that taxi cleaner, since there are some things we're going to want to cover while we're still in the shock.
Pull up, pull up.
Roger.
Altitude, altitude.
Winds calm. Visibility greater than 10 miles. Scattered 7,000. Temperature 4-1. Dew point 1-3. Altimeter 3. Seat of information Romeo and advise aircraft. On first contact, Nellis Air Force Base Information Romeo, time 2055. Winds calm. Visibility greater than 10 miles. Scattered 7,000 feet. Temperature 4-1. Dew point 1-3. Altimeter 3037. Runways in use 03 left, 03 right. Expect visual approach. Acknowledge receipt of information Romeo and advise aircraft type on first contact. Nellis Air Force Base Information Romeo, time 2055. Winds calm. Visibility greater than 10 miles. Scattered 7,000 feet. Temperature 4-1. Dew point 1-3. Altimeter 3037. Runways in use 03 left, 03 right. Expect visual approach. Acknowledge receipt of information Romeo and advise aircraft type on first contact. Nellis Air Force Base Information Romeo, time 2055. Winds calm. Visibility greater than 10 miles. Scattered 7,000 feet. Temperature 4-1. Dew point 1-3. Altimeter 3037. Runways in use 03 left, 03 right. Expect visual approach. Acknowledge receipt of information Romeo and advise aircraft type on first contact. Nellis Air Force Base information Romeo, time 2055. Winds calm. Visibility greater than 10 miles. Scattered 7,000 feet. Temperature 41. Dew point 13. Altimeter 3037. Runways in use 03 left, 03 right. Expect visual approach. Acknowledge receipt of information Romeo. Romeo and advise aircraft type on first contact. Nellis Air Force Base Information Romeo, time 2055. Winds.
Roger, that seems handy enough. Indeed. Within numerous sub-pages. The four primary pages are the missile control page, which of course controls our missiles. The selective jettison page, which allows us some options when it comes to what we jettison and how we'll do it. The inventory select page lets us mess with the inventory on a station-by-station basis. It also allows us to access some handy options for some of our munitions like CBUs and LGBs. And lastly, we have the status page, which we're on now, or we should be. Verify that you're on the status page by confirming that you do not see STAT under OSB-1.
Yep, I'm on the status page.
Word. So the status page will show us what is loaded on each of our 11 stations, and the status of each weapon, as well as the remaining round count and status of the gun. Our active profiles, release settings, and EO time for the 65s, if the maps are active, are also displayed here. Each station number is on the outer edge of each box. Starting in the bottom left, we have station 1, and all the way over on the bottom right, next to OSB 10, we have station 11. Looking at station 8, next to OSB 7, we see BBU 33 on the top line inside of the box. This indicates that we are carrying BDU 33s on that station. Under that, we see TER, signifying that they are being carried on the Brew 42 triple ejector rack. And on the inside of that box, we see 3, which says there are 3 bombs remaining on that station. You still awake? Oh, yeah. Hanging on every word. I believe it. Down in the bottom center, we should see 1150 TP, indicating that we have 1,150 rounds of training ammo remaining. Also notice the text is green and there are no red or nasty messages like a bunch of X's, which means our gun is FMC, or good to go, whereas the X's indicate your gun's bent. In the center of the display, we should see guns and weapons off in a white box. Gun signifies which HUD mode we are in, and weapons off means that our master arm switch is off. Does all that look about right? Yeah, I'm mirroring you so far. Great, press the mode button on the stick to cycle to the different master modes and you'll see that change. Also, putting the master arm switch down will put us into training mode, which will say weapons off, but in a nice pretty blue box, and you'll get another blue outline box with text that says training up above it. Flipping the switch into the arm position will show weapons off just in a green box and ground safe up above it since we have the ground safety override switch in the off position.
Maverick.
profile applies for all masks. And even though we're carrying caps, there's no profile settings for Sidewinder. Noted. On the left of the page, you'll see an up and down arrow next to OSV 19 and 20. Use those to select the profile that you want to look at. So press down to get us over to the BDU 33 profile. Okay, I've got the arrow next to it. Good, so now we should see a few options here. At OSB 3 we have view profile. OSB 9 allows us to turn the profile on or off. And at OSB 17 we have an option to activate that profile. So are you seeing the same thing? On and off does just that. With it on, while cycling through our weapons profile, we'll see it and can use it. If we turn it off, we won't be able to select it and employ that profile, and it won't be there when we're scrolling through our profiles unless we turn it back on. ACT Pro is what activates the profile or turns it back on for employment. Make sense? Alright, go ahead and hit OSB 3 for me. We should now find ourselves in the BDU 33 weapons profile page, yes? Roger. Very nice. The first thing I want to draw your attention to is the profile table. The table displays the release parameters for that profile. Note that the parameters you see within this table that are not underlined can only be adjusted within the inventory page, which we'll look at here in a bit.
Understood.
Below this table, you'll see 11 little boxes. Each box represents a station, and the green boxes you see for stations 4 and 8 indicate that we have BDUs on those stations. Back up at the top, we see selections at OSB 1 and 2 that will take us back to the Dismiss status page and the main profile pages, respectively. On the right, we see options for ripple settings, fusing, and release modes at OSB 6, 7, and 10. Press OSB 6 for me, 6 times, please. As you press it, you'll see it cycle through singles, pairs, ripple singles, ripple pairs, and you should wind up on ripple singles. Stop here, we see that we now have options to adjust the ripple quantity and the release spacing. Also at the top next to OSB 3, we should now have a save option, which should be flashing. Does that all jive with what you've got?
I'm jiving so hard.
Good to hear. Press OSB 16 for me, labeled CHGSET for change profile settings. That's what we wanted. Okay, so here we can adjust some more things, like our safe escape maneuver, desired time of flight, and minimum time of fall, and some other values for rack delay, vertical and lateral offsets, and eject velocity. We'll get a little deeper into a lot of this stuff when the time comes, but for now, just hit OSB 3 to save that profile, then hit OSB 1 again to get back to the status page. Let me know once you're there.
Okay, I'm back on the status page.
Right on. Now press OSB 5, and this should take us to the inventory page. Here, you can manually input information on what is loaded on that station and adjust settings for some of our munitions. So, let's tell the jet we have a G-12 on station 6. Let me know when you're on the inventory page and ready to go. Okay, so one nice thing about Dismas is that it knows what we can put on that station and what we can't. For instance, here on Station 6, there is no option to load a MAVS or a Wickman. For this example, though, we're going to load a GBU-12. So, looking on the right side, we see GBU next to 6. Inside of that page, we have options for GBU-10 and 12. Press OSB 19 for GBU-12, and give me a heads up when you're that far.
pod is powered up now.
Excellent. Right now the pod is powered up, but standby mode, as indicated by the green box, is jumping SGY underneath OS3. In standby mode, the ball will fill itself facing backwards, and you'll not get video or anything else from the targeting pod. Should you enable the pod, just simply press OS2 or 4 to put it into air to ground or air to air mode, respectively. Go ahead and put it in air to ground mode.
Again, closely tied to the CMSP is a radar Sierra warning receiver and CMSC, both of which are located on the front dash. The CMSC repeats some of the info found on the CMSP and adds a bit more. But for now, that's going to have to be the limit of our discussion on the countermeasure system as we're running a bit behind. Roger that. Sorry if I'm slowing us down. Nope, not at all. I have a tendency of talking a bit too much, so it's my fault. So with that being said, let's grab ADIS and get rolling. Once you've got it, give me a heads up. Roger. Please and thank you. Also, I'm not sure if I've told you, but we're looking for IFR to Dogbone. Roger. Stand by on 289 or put 4. Is rolling. And there's something sinister looking about buffs with loaded shoulder pylons.
Especially when they're calcums.
Yeah, no shit. That usually means something's getting ready to pop off.
Exactly.
Tusk 2-1, request takeoff.
Tusk 2-1, you are cleared for takeoff when ready. Climb 300 at QFE 28.42.
Thank you.
Process 2, Mills Tower. Contact departure 385.1.
Departure on 385.4, Process 2.
Alright, ready to pick up the training while we should have a few minutes?
Yep, let's start that right-hand turn for fighter and go ahead with the left.
Copy. started out with fence check. To rehash what I'm sure you already know, fence is an acronym that stands for fire control, electronic warfare, navigation, communication system, and lastly, measures. Again, I know you know all this, but with all the new Gucci shit in Charlie, there's gonna be different stuff to check. Roger. I'm there.
Blackjack, Tough 2 with you at Angel 14. Just passed fighter as frag.
Tough 2, enter your Bravo and 6 3 Bravo. Enter at 4 Alpha. You guys are clear at the range from now until 1430 local. Helicopter traffic 15 miles.
Blackjack, Tusk, enter 6-3 Bravo and fly direct to dog mode until 1400. We'll keep an eye out for traffic.
Tusk, this is Blackjack. You guys are clear at the ranch up until 1430. Everything else was correct, though.
1430, Tusk 2. Alright, putting what we just learned into practice, let's fence in together step by step. Ready? Let's do it. Okay, actually flipping switches this time. Fire control. Master arm, arm. Laser arm, arm. Gun pack, arm. Mav EO power, on. And let me know once you've got that accomplished. Electronic warfare, jammer, RWR, MWS, and dispenser, all on. Mode set to manual, semi-auto, or auto as desired. Countermeasures profile and ECM mode selected as required. Alright, everything's good there. Navigation, TAG, Saddle, Iggy, AAP, and CDU all happy and set up as desired and required. Flight plan sequencing set to manual if need be, which we'll discuss later. Roger, I'll get there. Com, radios configured as needed, frequency set. Finally, emitter, exterior lights off, pack and off, and that's it. Usually the lead will call fence in and state his or her fuel. Each person then will report when fence in and state their fuel only if they are more than 500 pounds plus or minus from what lead calls their fuel at. Roger, lead is fenced in.
Plus, your 7 is set up in orbit once we get there. This will put us about 14,000 feet, 10 miles or so away from the lake. At a good vantage point to have a look at what we're fixing to get into.
Roger.
Alright, looks like we're here. her in orbit for me, please, and let me know when you're ready to talk about her test. I thought so. Today we'll be working on the northern end. On the eastern edge of that northern bulge, you'll see some roads coming off towards the east. 1 mile down that road is stopped, and there you'll find the target we're going to be working today, the embattlement. That T-55 is going to have triple stack containers bracketing it to the north, south, and west to help you find it. Again, the tank in the middle of those is our target, not the container.
I think I can manage. Shoot the tank, not the containers, right?
Affirm, but since we're up here in a stable orbit, let's go ahead and look at what we can do with the gun and some other stuff in the IFC menu. When ready, place the IFC switch into the test position. Once you've done that, scroll down to Weapons and hit Enter on the UFC. Let me know when you're there.
Range.
hands up at us. The ranges here are pretty liberal with what we can and can't do, which allows for a lot of flexibility. We'll be using a few different ranges around the NCCR because of what each range offers. One is going to be closer to sea to where we'll do some hot pits. Some of the others offer different targets and threats that we can practice against. Today we'll be on Dogbone Lake. There's one just to the north of it called 61 Bravo, and one to the north of Creech called Fat.
That's hilarious.
It's pretty ridiculous. Anyway, sometimes we'll have a range control officer or RCO down there who we'll coordinate with. Oh, and there's supposed to be a JTAC unit coming through at some point that hopefully we'll get a work with.
That'd be awesome if it happens.
Yeah, it would be a great training opportunity for all involved. Go without saying, but just in case, if we're up here working with an RCO, JTAC, or any other controlling entity, we have to abide by their directions and restrictions. All of the coordination and planning should be done days prior to the sortie. We should step with a pretty solid game plan on what we're going to be doing, who is going to be there, and how we're going to be doing it. Just like anything else, though, shit does change from time to time. The RCO will give us a heads up on any changes to the game plan. Just make sure if you give you a final attack heading that you fly that damn heading or anything else they tell you to do.
Roger.
Range uses is coordinated through obstacles to Blackjack as part of the flying schedule. Blackjack should give us range clearance when they give us entry into the NCCR just like they did today. They should tell us what range we're cleared on, what times we're good for, and if there's any other applicable information that we might want to know about. Like the helicopter traffic to our north we got earlier with our range entry clearance. More shit like what we're doing today, we're just going to go up here and practice some initial weapon stuff. We'll keep all the restrictions pretty simple. We'll have a final attack heading, but we'll keep the simple flying user patterns around the range. We're just egressing back to the hold for 4-hour attack. Nothing fancy until we get some of this shit nailed down.
Sounds pretty reasonable.
The last thing we need to do before we get started today is to let Blackjack know that we're pushing over to the range freak and make a call on that freak, let know any traffic in the area that we're here and that we're going to be using it. We'll monitor that frequency until we're done here, then we'll pop back over to 377.8 and recontact Blackjack. Go ahead, let Blackjack know, then push 234.25 and make an announcement for Dogbone.
Blackjack, Test 2 is on station at Dogbone, switching to the range tree.
Test 2, Blackjack, copy. Have fun.
visual on the target and ready to set up for an attack.
Alright, real quick before I clear you in, let's talk about the CCIP gun reticle, which I forgot earlier.
Come on, dude.
I know, dude. Sorry to be a cock tease, but we need to go over. So, CCIP gun reticle is the default reticle for the gun, and it offers the most information. Go ahead and ensure that you're in gun's master mode and get yourself into an altitude where you can see it as we talk about it. Something like 4,000 feet AGL should work nice. Yeah, the gun system is pretty much unchanged. I think there's some difference in the vents on the nose, and the cyclic is now locked at 3,900 rounds per minute. No more of the high-low cyclic.
The cyclic was fixed rate at 3,900 still when I flew the hog before, but yeah, I think that's about it.
Ah, okay. Well, on to the minimum range view. So, the MRC is going to use that 1,500 feet AGL we put in the IFT earlier as its minimum range. When you input anything other than zero into the minimum range, you're going to get that minimum range cue off the right-hand side of the reticle. It'll start about level with the top of the reticle and fall to the bottom. Its position is a visual indication as to how close you are to the minimum recovery altitude. When it's knelt to the top, you are more than 5 seconds from your set min out. Once you get to 5 seconds out of it, it will start to fall. As it passes the reticle 3 o'clock, you are at the minimum altitude. And when it falls to the bottom, you are more than 5 seconds past the min out.
Got it?
Yeah, I think so. At the top, you're good. It starts falling inside of 5 seconds to your preset minimum range. At 3 o'clock, you are at the minimum, and anything below that, you bust at the minimum.
Exactly. Let me get up on my soapbox here before I clear your eyes.
Oh, yay.
I'm sure you've heard it a million times before, and you'll hear it again after me. It is damn easy to get target fixation when you're on the trigger. Guys, and it will kill more. Don't be that guy. Use all the tools the jet offers you to avoid that. Hell, there are three things in the CCIP gun rectal alone that should help mitigate that risk. You've got the analog range bar, the minimum range cue, and the digital range at the bottom. Use those things and pay attention to them. Know when it's time to come off drive and pass goes to shit.
Understood. One of the problems I was at DM with damn near went in. Some cactuses with the tail pulling out. Both the horizontal and vertical stabs were all chewed up on the leading edges. That did not go over too well.
Yeah, I'd imagine not. At least he walked away and brought the jet hole more or less in one piece. A lot of guys don't. On the positive note, I ran out of shit to talk about for the moment. Ready to gun some Russian armor?
Shit, yeah.
Okay, I'll act as a half-assed RCO since it's been a minute for you, and it's your first time here at Dogbone. Let's try and keep our passes resembling something like a landing pattern, with an upwind, downwind, crosswind, and base leg. Keep your final attack heading east to west, or 270, plus or minus 30 degrees. So a flying attack heading somewhere between 240 and 300. Then come off to the right or back to the north. Sound good?
Pull up, pull up. Altitude, altitude. Pull up, pull up.
Two one is in from the east.
Pull up, pull up. Altitude, altitude. Pull up, pull up. Pull up, pull up. Altitude, altitude. Pull up, pull up.
Miles the way to the bottom. We're relegated to using only one
combat mix, and we don't have the moving target index line either. We do get to keep our minimum range cue when it's used, and that's about it. Oh, an X will be displayed in the middle of the gun cross when the solution is out of the HUD's field of view, or when there's no altitude source.
So really, the only claim to fame for this is that it's less intrusive on the HUD than the CCIP gun reticle?
Yep, that's pretty much it. But sometimes that in and of itself makes all the difference. Have a go with it so I can check that box, and we'll move on to the other. Same thing here, shoot another 350 rounds, and save me about 500 left in the drum.
Roger that. Stop at or around 500.
Good shit. Same attack restrictions. Keep your fires to the west. It's cleared hot when ready.
Final attack heading from the east. Tusk 2-1.
Altitude, altitude. Pull up, pull up. Altitude, altitude. Warning, autopilot.
Version does. Now you're probably wondering, why the hell do we need these when you have their CCID counterparts. Well, I'm gonna tell you.
Thank God. I can't stand it any longer.
Ha ha.
Suppose you don't have accurate ranging information, like, if you're shooting at something on a mountain that's actually above your aircraft. In that instance, you're not going to get a valid or accurate CCID solution. This is where you'd want to use one of these rectangles. When you're at a slant range of 12, 8, or 4,000 feet, you know where those rounds are going to impact.
That actually makes sense.
Of course it does. Just make sure you're paying attention, smartass. So, we actually have some targets here that I'd like you to use one of those rectangles on. At waypoint 10, you're going to find a bunker near the top of the mountain. Run in from the west this time and put a burst on it. Again, make your final attack heading west to east and come in below the target's altitude.
Okay, so final attack heading at 090 and approach from below the target.
Stay firm. You know what? We've got the time. On your first pass, run in from below and try using either the CCIP gun cross or the CCIP gun rectangle. Let me know what happens. You're cleared in dry when ready.
Okay, so use one of the CCIP reticles. Clear dry for Tusk 2-1.
Altitude. Altitude. Pull up. Altitude.
Attack complete. All right, return to the hold and we'll talk about a few more aspects of a well-rounded gun pack. Let me know once you're established in an orbit at the hold. At a basic level. The next part is successfully employing it in a tactical scenario. The parameters of a particular situation can and will dictate how you will attack the target. Should you go in with a high or low angle strafe? How long of a burst? Which aspect would be best for you to attack the target from? The list goes on. In a nutshell, the further away you're shooting, the less accurate the gun is. If you're attacking an area target or soft target, you can get on the trigger at 2 miles. Targets you'll want to get a little bit closer if the situation permits. For armor, like main battle tanks, get in as close as you dare. An ideal pass would be a 2 second burst starting at a 4,000 foot slant range. Regardless of where you start shooting, you want to stop shooting at 3,000 feet or, to quote a friend, you run the risk of flying into your own bullets and or frag, which is usually considered bad form. Slant range is inversely proportional to the bullet's kinetic energy on the target. So, the closer you are to the target, not only do more of your bullets hit where you want them to, but they also hit harder. What about dive angles? We typically either use a low angle strafe, up to something like 15 degrees, and a high angle strafe, which we like to keep between 20 and 45 degree dive angles. We do have a high 60 profile, which interesting, especially when you blow the roll in and wind up closer to 80 degrees. Many different factors can determine which dive angles you can use. In most scenarios, the high angle strafe is going to be your preferred choice. Roger. Back to shooting in armor. I forgot to mention that it's best to try and gun them from the side, or better yet, the rear, where their armor is thinner, in case you've forgotten that. The Gal is also pretty handy in the anti-personnel role. In this regime, a little round dispersion can be a good thing. So, you may want to employ a long-range, low-angle strafe. Hell, I've even heard of folks turning off packs to better walk the rounds around the target area. Just remember, ROEs, terrain, proximity to friendlies, weather condition, and a myriad of other factors can always change how you conduct your attack. So, you may not always be able to employ how you'd like. Just be flexible and ready to adapt.
For sure. I'm sure being fluid in any situation can have huge dividends in the cast role, or really any other role we may find ourselves in.
Oh, no doubt. In the cast role, we wind up being that impetus to serve the change within a fight a lot of the time. That's our goal. We want to remove the enemy from the fight, or at the very least, remove the fight from them. As we do this, the battlefield changes. They may fall back to a different position, or our guys may react and move forward or flank. We need to be ready and capable to react to any change in the ground situation in a quick and accurate fashion. So yeah, fluidity is key. Okay, enough philosophy for today. Let me get you to execute that 20 degree to 45 degree high angle strafe on that 55 hole that we've been playing with. When would we want to employ that high angle strafe again?
45 degrees and give me a 2-second burst at about 4,000.
Roger, Tusk 2-1 inbound on P-55.
Keep your fires to the west, egress back to the hold, you are cleared hot.
Tusk 2-1.
Altitude, altitude. Pull up, pull up. Altitude. Pull up. Altitude. Pull up.
One's off. Alright, bro. I think that's all for today. Still have some gun ammo and don't feel like so to get back to Nellis. We still own this range for a little bit longer, so feel free to expend it. So, do you want to RTB and head home, or do you want to make a few more passes?
Altitude. Pull up. Altitude.
Roger, turning for steer 1-1 and looking for Angel 1-4.
Go ahead and send out since we're leaving the range. Let me know when you're ready to do that.
I'll do just that.
silence approach on 291.725.
Contact approach 291.725 for Tusk 2. See ya.
Push departure.
You mean approach?
Yep, my bad.
Two's up.
Let's pop over to 270.1 and grab Aegis real quick.
Two.
Visibility greater than 10 miles. Scattered 7,000. Temperature 41. 2.13. Altimeter 3021. Runway 03 left.
I've got Aegis and I'm back over on approach when you're ready to hit them up.
7,000 feet. Temperature 41, 2.13. Altimeter 3021. Runway 503 left, 03 right. Expect visual approach.
Altitude.
Tusk 2-1, inbound.
Tusk 2-1, fly heading 149.43, QFE 28.42, runway 21, 2,000 altitude.
Cessna 2, radar contact. Uniform is current. Continue inbound for Nellis. Expect a visual for 1 left.
S22 contact tower, V27.70, good day.
S22-1, switching to tower, see ya. Nellis tower, S22-1 is 5 miles out, inbound, full stop.
S22-1, Nellis tower, winds calm, clear to land on
V1.
Altitude.
tower. Vacate at Alpha. Contact ground when able.
Vacate at Alpha and contact ground, Tusk.
Find aircraft.